Good afternoon. It is my honor to introduce the four distinguished speakers at the Higher Education Panel. Professor Philip Altebach. Professor Philip Altebach is Donald Monon SJ University Professor, Director of the Center for International Higher Education, Lynch School of Education at Boston College. Professor Altebach was the 2004 to 2006 Distinguished Scholar Leader for the New Century Scholars Initiative of the Fulbright Program, and in 2010 was an erudite scholar of the government of Kerala in India. Professor Altebach's most recent book, co-edited with Jamal Selmi, is The Road to Academic Excellence, The Making of World-Class Research Universities. He's author of Turmoil and Transition, The International Imperative in Higher Education, Comparative Higher Education, Student Politics in America, and other books. Professor Ji Shun Zhang. Professor Ji Shun Zhang is a professor of history at East China Normal University and an adjunct professor of Fudan University. She earned her Bachelor of Arts and Master of Arts at Beijing Normal University and a PhD in law from Fudan University in 1998. She taught at Fudan University from 1985 to 2000 and was a visiting scholar at the Institute of East Asian Studies, UC Berkeley. Her research focuses on the history of urban Shanghai during the ROC and PRC periods. She has published a book, Chinese Intellectuals' Views on America, 1943 to 1953, and numerous articles. Professor You Mingxi. Professor You Mingxi is Executive President of Xi'an Jiaotong Liverpool University, Pro Vice Chancellor of University of Liverpool, Professor of Management of Xi'an Jiaotong University, Executive Vice Dean of Shanxi MBA College. In 1987, he was awarded the first doctoral degree in Management Engineering in mainland China, and in 1993, he became the youngest supervisor of PhD candidates in Management Engineering in China. As a visiting professor, Professor Xi has conducted joint research projects and discourses in universities of Canada, America, Singapore, and Japan, as well as Hong Kong, Macau, and Taiwan. Professor Xi's research and teaching areas cover strategic management and policy analysis, decision making and decision support system, management behavior and firm theory, etc. He established harmony theory in 1987 and developed to harmonious management theory. Dr. Xiaoyan Liang. Dr. Liang formally joined the World Bank as a young professional in 1998 after having obtained a Doctor of Education degree from Harvard University Graduate School of Education. Since then, she has led policy dialogue and managed education programs in many countries in Africa, Latin America, and in East Asia region. Dr. Liang has wide-ranging research and operational expertise and interests, including early childhood education, skills development, higher education, science and technology, education finance, and teacher education. Currently, Dr. Liang is leading the World Bank's China Education Program, which focuses on skills development and early childhood education. Each speaker at the panel will speak for 15 minutes, then Professor Altebach will be the facilitator, will then open up for question and answer. So first, let's welcome Professor Zhang for her presentation.
Thank you for 因为我是从事历史研究的，所以我想我对中国高等教育的研究就从历史一直讲到现在。我讲的这个报告跟首先跟一个圣约翰大学有关，它是建立于1879年，结束于1952年，它是美国圣公会在中国建立的一个。 教会大学，另一所学校就是去年刚刚新鲜出炉的上海纽约大学。相隔了130多年，圣约翰大学和上海纽约大学分别在上海的苏州河边和浦东的陆家嘴落户。 期间一个多世纪，美国大学经历了1952年被中国政府裁撤赶走，和2012年再度进军的历史悲喜剧。这两个事件就触发了历史的联想，一些圣约翰校友敏感地发问：是不是圣约翰又回来了？断裂的历史是否又接上了呢？作为历史学者和上海纽约大学曾经的参与者和见证人，我想聚焦于全球化、本土化、美国化和普世价值这四个概念，提出若干思考和大家一起讨论和分享。我想现在大家非常熟悉的就是这个梦的问题。那么这两所大学的建立其实是跟一个跨世纪的美国梦有关。建立全球网络的这个精神驱力和先锋式的冒险力行，就是这两所大学前后相互关照的连贯性。当我们看到上海纽约大学的官网上赫然写着让世界成为你的课堂，你不要以为这是只是一句吸引人招生广告的这样一句话，它呢确实是一个正在形成的全球性的网络所支撑。上海纽约大学是继纽约大学的曼哈顿校园和阿布扎比校园之后的第三个纽约大学的全球性的门户校园，而纽约大学别出心裁的校园选择阿拉伯世界的阿布扎比和共产党中国的上海，也包含着相当的开拓精神和风险意识。当年的圣约翰，他的出现无疑是基督教传教士们全球扩张的热忱所致，他们始终强调教会大学必须是真正的教会事业的一部分，能够在行为方式、为人处事等各个方面影响他的学生像真正的基督教徒一样。在很长的时间内，圣约翰大学也确实是美国圣公会在上海教区的大本营。两个学校又同时把目光聚焦到了上海，在西方人看来，也许上海这座城市最适合西方的大学在这里扎根，但是他们同时聚焦上海，遭遇却完全不同。当年圣约翰他的出现既依托了上海这个特权，这个殖民地的这个租界的特权，既造就了这个圣约翰当年无可比拟的辉煌，同时呢也使得他留下了独特的难堪和非常苦涩的记忆。1925年五卅运动当中的国旗事件，就是他的校长不准这个他的师生在校园里升国旗来悼念这个中国被枪杀的这个同胞，所以呢造成了500多名圣约翰的师生离校，使得圣约翰从盛而衰。而纽约大学的全球梦想是来自他背靠的大都市，他尤其是他和华尔街之间形成有形无形的紧密联系的纽带，以及他作为世界都市文化的样板又难以复制的纽约文化，实在是纽约大学能够成为学费高昂但最受考生欢迎的和向往的大学之一，并且一路凯歌在排行榜上扶摇直上的重要背景。正是倚重着这份历史资源，纽约大学试图让全球梦想在上海落地，而他的这个梦想能够现在一步一步地走到今天，确实获得了圣约翰当年不可企及的待遇，浦东陆家嘴寸土寸金的宝地，新建的教学大楼和设施以及开办经费全部由浦东新区政府和上海市教委划拨或者资助。从筹备到今年开始招生短短2年多，从中央相关部委到上海市地方政府，所有的批文几乎一路绿灯。上海纽约大学得到中国高层领导的大力支持，尤其令人瞩目的是去年12月5号，中共中央新任总书记习近平邀请了20位在华工作的专家座谈，外国专家座谈，上海纽约大学的执行副校长 Jeff Lehman 荣幸地受到邀请。那么是不是可以认为那个发源于世界伟大理念之都的纽约梦想 是否可以在另外一个世界理念之都变成现实。那么我们下面就要看一看他们这两所大学曾经和现在都面临的一个不可回避的问题。如果说民族主义的浪潮使得美国传教士的全球梦想屡遭挫败的话，那么今天上海纽约大学面临的本土化问题比起民族主义更加广泛，更具挑战性。这在教会大学时期就面临过，今天仍然是中国和西方和外部世界打交道的基本问题。在圣约翰的年代里，本土化的一个最重要的标尺就是教育主权问题。在美国基督教在华差会所办的大学中，圣约翰被人关注的特点之一就是最早成立和最晚向中国政府注册。在它存在的73年时间里，有68年是在中国土地上但只是在美国注册的大学，所以这所大学的国籍变成了一个非常奇特的问题。而它在中国政府立案的迟滞也常常遭到指责和麻烦，而上海纽约大学的国籍却在法律上已经不成问题，但是它在文化的意义上，它是中国的还是美国的，似乎还是一道模糊的数学题。而且比之法律意义上的本土化，文化意义上的本土化更为艰深与复杂。在圣约翰的年代，在近代中国犹如全盘西化之不可能，美国人在中国办学而非本土化也实在是梦想。当年的圣约翰从法律事实一直到社会形象，美国印记是那么的醒目，开创性的全英文教学也是经常为后人赞许的一条成功之道。然而圣约翰到底衰在哪里，败在哪里，恐怕值得深究。民族主义运动的冲击，受立案风波的影响，以及最终被毛时代的反美浪潮吞噬，这些都是原因。而其中被忽视的一个重要的内因，也就是由圣约翰培养起来的一代一代操着流利英语、熟悉甚至崇拜美国的精英，绝大部分的骨子里都有很强的中国认同。难怪当年的美国传教士百思不得其解的是，为什么中共一来就吸引了绝大多数教会大学的师生，而基督教却无法表现出这样一种力量。如果说本土化问题在圣约翰的那个时代多少带有一点伪问题意味的话，那么今天在中国这个问题不仅现实而且严峻。从殖民主义时代到全球化的网络时代，一个最基本的变化是中国人全球的流转和资讯变得十分迅速和便捷。从教育这条渠道而言，西方和美国知识的获取不再为少数人所垄断，但中国传统文化和价值的窘境也前所未有的凸显。上海纽约大学提出的结合美国的博雅教育体系来和中国传统文化的精华，为师生提供最佳的教育体验，的确是非常美好的愿望，但不难发现其中的美国体系清晰明了，而中国精华则难以名状。何为中国教育传统精华，如何让师生获得最佳教育体验，还需上下求索。切勿以为以中国文化课程来取代马列教育就万事大吉。从1949年到1979年，中国从封闭的毛泽东时代走向了开放的邓小平时代，中国对世界的认知维度由此而发生了重大的变化，由忆苦思甜的纵向思维到以及还有2/3的人民生活在水深火热之中的闭门想象，转到放眼世界的左顾右盼。思路的转变对中国人的思想解放和中国的崛起的意义难以估量，积极意义难以估量。但近代以来崇洋媚外，特别是崇美思潮和心态也借机卷土重来，其深度比之过去无不有过之而无不及。在这种思潮和心态的推助下，强势的美国文化犹如一个磁场，吸引着一代中国青年，一代又一代的中国青年，相形之下 美中国教育和文化的传统显得僵化与迷惘，各种教育也似乎回天乏力。在这样的文化生态中，作为被崇拜者的上海纽约大学，是否应该首先引导学生，特别是占学校51%的中国学生，去认识一个真实的美国，学会批判美国，使之培养学生思维批判性思维的第一课。当中国经济取得惊人成就的时候，春秋时代的礼崩乐坏的社会文化情境似有重现。在这一情境中，拜金主义权力腐败不断地扼杀着中国文化的生机，教育也难免受到波及。现如今的中国大学已不是一片绿洲一方净土，所以在谈及上海纽约大学本土化的问题时，也包含了对他捍卫教育本质、坚守大学使命的期待。在探索全球化和本土化的办学之路之时，上海纽约大学最需要值得警惕的就是学校教育的美国化。因为无可回避的是，美国对于近代普世价值的创造和贡献是巨大的，其中包括了当年传教士们的办学之举。但这一切近乎一把双刃剑，一方面近代文明进步因此受益匪浅，他方面则酿成了美国的强势文化在全球化时代的霸权。不管你承认与否，当今的全球化是美国化等于美国化是一个不争的事实。当然，对于一所美国大学来说，警惕美国化这一要求近乎苛刻。然而，如果没有这个自觉，那么在美国创造的经验和价值面前，上海纽约大学至多是一个守成者，在全球化就是美国化的现实面前，至多在天上一砖一瓦。倘若这样，纽约大学全球办学将是一个徒劳无功之举。值得庆幸的是，上海纽约大学的开创者具有这样的先见，他的招生广告上我们听到了这样的声音：在这样一个具有空前活力的时代，综合对不同文化和观点的认识，摆脱美国中心论的思维定式非常重要。上海纽约大学希望为学生提供一个共同研究和解决全球性问题的平台。我们欢迎的是具有世界公民的学生，我们的学生将成为连接不同思想文化的桥梁。与殖民主义时代的终结一样，圣约翰大学一去不复返。但即便如此，在圣约翰的教育模式中仍有其精髓，不失为上海纽约大学可资传承和借鉴。正如著名的历史学家张开元先生所说，中国教会大学的结局是悲剧性的，但故事本身并非悲剧。纽约大学的辉煌是由校长朴方济主政时期建立起来的圣约翰模式铸就的，其最大的成功是在朴方济坚持自由教育即通识教育的理念，倡导文理兼容，德智体美四育并进，及其之要点就在于教育的本质，或称大学的使命是促进人的全面发展，以达国家社会之进步与昌盛。从自由教育理念派生的这个圣约翰模式，是朴方济从古希腊文明的博雅教育中吸取精髓，又糅合了近代基督教教育以德为先的原则，全面引入美国大学制度综合而成，与中国传统的精英教育也有切合之处。从这个意义上来说，这个美国学校秉承和创造的并不是一个美国教育模式，其中最为核心的价值是普世的，也是历久弥新的经典。正因为这样，圣约翰教育模式并没有随着学校的裁撤而从中国大陆上匿迹。且不说当下中国高等教育改革中通识教育不断地以各种表达各种形式被高扬，如元培班、复旦学院等等竞相实验，就是在通识教育培养通才被当作亲美崇美思想受到严厉批判 和清算的17年教育中，德智体全面发展一直是响亮的教育方针，被嫁接到毛泽东培养有社会主义觉悟的、有文化的劳动者的意识形态之中。正是蕴含在圣约翰模式中的普世价值，超越了1949年的鸿沟对上海纽约大学的全球之梦，仍然有传世和指导的意义。在今天，我们尤其需要思考和探索的是，在铺天盖地的科技网络时代，作为一个有限实体的人的组织网络，上海纽约大学如何以鲜活的人文精神和深邃的智慧去造就完整意义的人，而不是培养出越来越多高超的技术人去扼杀人的本性和灵魂。话要说回来，作为一所中美合作的大学，我们不能寄希上海纽约大学解决高等教育面临的那些最棘手甚至带有全局性的问题，不能给他过分的责任。但有一点愿望是实在的，那就是上海纽约大学非但不会像圣约翰大学那样结束，而且要创造出大大超越于圣约翰、华东师大以及纽约大学的教育新经验和思想文化财富。作为一个历史学者，而且当前我正在哈佛燕京跟 Liz Perry 教授一起研究圣约翰大学的历史，同时也作为上海纽约大学从朦胧设想到破土动工的亲历者和见证人，我比任何人都希望看到他的成功。但是我今天的这个发言应该说可能是既不讨好我的学校，也不讨好纽约大学，但是我希望这篇批判多于赞扬、提问多于建议的文字作为他通往成功路上的一颗小小的铺路石子。谢谢。
Thank you, Professor Zhang, for your insightful comparison of St. John's and NYU Shanghai. Next, let's welcome Professor Xi to give his presentation.
Hey, good afternoon. It's my pleasure to hear, to share some ideas about the International Cooperative University in China. I want to use this title to give my main idea about the university, rethinking and redefine university, a journey to create a unique international university in China. The Xi'an Jiao Tong University, in short, is XJTLU. I want to talk in four perspectives. One is about XJTLU, another one is several critical issues for education and educator. For example, why we need to rethink, redefine, and reshape the university education and learn teaching. And why we need to explore the new model. The third is to introduce briefly about the exploration of XJTLU. And finally, I will give you our solutions and the challenges. First, where is XJTLU? XJTLU is created in 2006 and located in Suzhou. Suzhou is near Shanghai. It takes 20 minutes by the speed train from Shanghai, Suzhou to Shanghai. Currently, Xi'an Jiao Tong University has nearly 7,500 students. We are trying to recruit 12,000 and to 17,000 students in future. XJTLU position it as a research-led university. This year we have our first master students and one PhD students graduated this year. And we have a fourth cohort of graduates this year. We developed the business school this year. So that's briefly introduction about XJTIU. Secondly, I want to give you some reasons why we need to rethinking, reshape university and education. Look at this picture. We can think that's a picture described about a network to the world. All the people, all the things connected by the network. This morning, Professor Philippou has mentioned about disruptive learning technology and its impact on education. He thought it's a wake-up call for education. I think for XJTA, we have got up. We have run. So when we think in this network world, many things have changed. For example, we have to change our learning and teaching behavior. So everything, perhaps everything is thinking about its next generation. So we have to think about university. What's the next generation of university? So I think because the learning behavior has been changed, we need to think why students can learn knowledge in home. Students needn't to go to campus to learn knowledge. So we need to rethink what's the purpose, what's the function, what's the value of campus, of the university. And in this networked world, we can find the learning behavior has been changed a lot. Look at this picture. In the internal side, it's a informal learning. That means at the external side, we can find the formal learning, traditional way. We have textbook, we have tiered curriculum, but currently, many students spend a lot of time to conduct informal learning, not formal learning. So we have to think, what's the next generation of education? And look at this picture. From the left side, that's a traditional way. The students sit down in classroom, the teacher teaching courses, teaching knowledge point, especially in Chinese context. But here, look at this side, the right side. Students at the center, that's the way of XJTU. XJTU is trying to change its students from ordinary students to be a global citizen. The student in center, the teachers, and the university develop a platform for students to learn by themselves. When students have some problem, they can get the guidance, can get help from students, from professors, from teachers. So we need to rethink what's a new way for the student to learn in university? What's a new way for teachers to teach in a class? So that's the challenges. That's challenges students and the university are facing. So third, what's the exploration of XJTAU? XJTAU is was created by two universities. One is the University of Liverpool, one is the Xi'an Jiaotong University. But we don't want to copy a UK model. In the Western world, certainly there is a Western core value of culture. For example, Western world pay attention to science, law, and religion. And the Western world has its own best practice in education. And certainly in China, Chinese culture has its core value, and the Chinese society has its own education best practice. But according to currently challenges, we have to rethink what's the new way for the university, for education to meet the future demands. So we need to think, what's the next generation? What's the future development trends? And how for university to train the student to meet the future demand? So according to future demand and by blending the Western best practice and the Eastern best practice, XJTAU is trying to develop a unique education model. That's our purpose. So after several years exploration, we reach this vision. So actually at TIU want to be a research-led international university in China and a Chinese university recognized internationally with its unique features. I think here we can explain this vision in different perspective. First, because most of the Chinese parents and the students are not satisfied with Chinese education system. So they are trying to send their kids to study abroad. So look at this room, many students are Chinese. But the parents are afraid of two things. One is very expensive. I think most of you know, very expensive for you study in abroad. The another thing is that many parents are afraid of that. The students just finished the high school, could not adapt to the external environment. So that's the two very important things. So XGTU is want to develop an international university in Chinese context. It gives students opportunity to study in a familiar environment. And then when they grow up, they can go abroad, no problem. So that's why we focus on the international university in Chinese context. But the Chinese government, the Chinese culture, and China is a hot place in the next few decades. So many foreigners are trying to study in China. So XGTAU teaching courses in English and accredited by international quality assurance agent. So it's easy for the foreigner to study in this university. And at the same time, they can learn Chinese, they can understand better about the Chinese culture. So that's our target, internationally and home students. I have mentioned about the uniqueness because we don't want to copy. Because any top university has its advantages, strengths, and weakness. So why we copy the weakness when we create a new one? So that's why we are trying to develop a unique university. In order to reach this objective, we have to develop a research-led university. Because if the university, it's not easy for a teaching university to attract top research or top professors or top scholars. So our university position research-led university as our target. What's the uniqueness? We have many ideas about the uniqueness. First, we need to rethink about what's the unique, what's the next generation of university? What's the new education model? What's the new organization structure for the university to operate? And also the management methodology, campus culture. We have a very clear explanation about our uniqueness. For example, here we pay more attention to this one, not to staff. And in our viewpoint, staff, campus, the importance of staff and campus reduced compared with the last decades. Now it's more important for the new university to have a new education philosophy and a system to give students and the staff opportunity to integrate in the international environment. So that's our philosophy. And we are trying to test a new model about to improve the knowledge workers efficiency and the efficiency of knowledge organization. So we use a very flat network organization structure. Here is our education model. Because time is limited, I don't want to go to in detail. So in our university, we are trying to help the students to change at least in five perspectives. First is to learn some knowledge on science and the technology. And secondly, it's very important to help the student to learn how to learn. And thirdly, to help the student to understand how to deal with the interpersonal relationship. Third, help the student to have international view, perspective. And finally, help the student to understand their own value and what kind of role they should play in future. So that's our purpose. So after several years development, we have reached our five-star education model. You can look at this. This research model is come from a comparison about culture, education model, and integrate the wisdom of the international to develop this education model to help students to change from ordinary people to be a global citizen with three systems, knowledge system and the philosophy value system and the capability system with the support of education strategy and the support systems. We have detailed explanation about this one, knowledge and the culture. We recruit staff internationally. So that's currently we have nearly 500 academic staff. Our teaching language is English. We have had three cohorts of graduates. Because our students are first year students and their parents, their family are in a good financial condition. So most of students are not satisfied to find a job just after their graduation. So most of them, currently 90% of them are continuing in their postgraduate studies in the world. Top 10, 15% of them enter the top 10 university, and 50% of them, more than 50% of them enter the top 100 university in the world, ranking by Times. Finally, I think give a very brief summarize our practice. First, in our university, we are trying to help. We don't think university is a place to learn knowledge. Learn knowledge is a content-based education model. And currently, we think it's very important to develop, to help students to develop some competence in the university. So we are here are key three key points of our university. First, the purpose is to help students to develop higher skills. Second, help students to find their interest in the field and to interest guide the learning. And thirdly, we are students and the learning-centered environment. Secondly, we are trying to help students to transform in three dimensions. First is from kids to young adults and to global citizens. Secondly, from passive learn to active learn and to research-led learn. Thirdly, from aimless learning to interest-oriented learn and then to pay attention to life plan. And in our university, we promote research-led working, research-led teaching, and research-led learning. We are trying to integrate the comparative advantages of three main systems. One is the UK system. The UK system is strong in quality assurance system. And the US system is give students more room to design by themselves. And the Chinese system and the Russia system is develop, help students to learn, to create a solid foundation of knowledge. So XGITU is trying to develop this a system to integrate the three comparative advantages in our system. And finally, we are trying to develop three levels of ecosystem. One is a nature ecosystem. Our campus should be an ecosystem. And secondly is knowledge eco. It's easy for students to and staff to share knowledge. And finally, we take university as part of society and open the university, integrate the university into a society and give society more chance to enter the university. That's our system. In order to implement this objective, we have to develop five awareness. It's not easy. So first is student awareness and the staff awareness and the faculty awareness and the parent awareness. Because in Chinese context, parent play a very important role on education. So we need to let parent understand what we are doing in the university. And also, we need to convince MOE, DOE, and other universities, peers. I think I have no time. If you are interested, I can answer question. I can answer something during the question and the answer session. Only go very fast. How to implement our target, our objective. I want to share some picture for you because Suzhou, welcome to Suzhou. Look at that's our campus, that's our central building. And because Philip has visited us several years ago, he asked me, "What's your new building?" I will move into this building in July. That's a very big building. That's some new building. When you visit Suzhou, there's no such building, but we have used in last year. That's our source campus. I will develop ourselves some view in our campus. Okay, thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Xi, for a detailed introduction of Xijiao Liverpool University. Next, we have Dr. Liang to present a vocational and technical education project in China.
Sorry. Good afternoon. Thank you very much for your attention. I hope you're still awake. It's been a long day. First of all, it's truly an honor to be in such a distinguished panel, and also very pleased to be back in my old school. When people talk about higher education, most of us tend to think about those wonderful examples of Shanghai, New York, or Xi'an, Liverpool. But I would like to bring your attention to the often forgotten side of higher education that is also tertiary, but vocational colleges. But before I do that, this is a World Bank project. It's a combination of some of our research analytical work, as well as our projects operating in China. Before I go to the project, some of the government recent reforms over vocational colleges, I'd like to speak a little bit more about the demand side, labor market, and the overall trends in China, and in particular in Yunnan province, where we had conducted some surveys in 2012. This must be a wrong version. Okay, so some context. I'm going to perhaps flood you with some numbers, and this is what we do in the World Bank, so I apologize. You must be very familiar with China, but in a very brief summary, this is our economy. We are in the 12th five-year planning where the government says we are now focusing on transforming the economy. What do they mean when they say that? Perhaps in three quick ways, from investment-led to consumption-led, from high carbon to green growth, and from being the low-cost factory of the world, hopefully to rely on technology innovation. And here, most of us in education will know the crucial role education and training will play in facilitating this transformation. A little bit on the context, Yunnan, the World Bank operate right now in about four provinces in China, including Yunnan, which is one of the most backward, economically backward provinces. This is really a wrong version, but I will try to work with this. Some trends in employment. China, despite currently so much talk about China economy growth being the star of development, still we are primarily quite agricultural, especially in the western part of China. There is a very clear change in the structure of employment over the last 20 years to the extent that by 2010, the blue part is this is Yunnan, 60% of our workers still engage in agriculture. The top green part is the service sector, which is rapidly increasing. That is the employment in the service sector, and also the share of non-public sector employment has doubled in Yunnan. It's also true actually China-wide. I had some slight change for China, but I see now I only have Yunnan here. I'll skip that. This is what we normally use to measure labor productivity, GDP per person employed. I have here some comparative data comparing China, OECD, and some of the East Asia countries. You can see the China line is the one that's coming up rapidly, the blue line going up, and so right now, labor productivity, even though increasing very rapidly, it's still quite low. It's about one fourth of the OECD average, at about $11,000 per year. Within Asia, of course, we lag behind China, Japan, Korea, but we also continue to lag behind Malaysia and Thailand. Within China, there's very significant regional disparity. It's between the eastern and the western regions. So some trend on the our labor force level of education. You see, in this chart is for Yunnan, it's not very obvious, but overall in China, you see a huge reduction in the people with only primary education. By now, most people who are in the labor force have obtained at least 9 years of basic education. Or most of them actually have almost 12 years of education. The one with comparison is within China, across provinces, we see a huge difference. Here we are on the right side with Beijing, Shanghai, with more than almost 50-60% of the workers have upper secondary or tertiary level of education. You have on the left side, Tibet, Guizhou, and Yunnan, very much very low in terms of workers' profile in education. So in 2012, we did some surveys, household survey in Kunming, and we tried to update what is going on with the returns to education. I know there's a lot of controversy on using returns to education for investment in education, but it's still worthwhile to have some understanding of the trend over the last 10 or 15 years. So you see the red line is for China, the blue line for Yunnan, and continually return to education is positive. Every year you get about at least 7 to 8, 9 return in terms of labor market performances for workers. In Kunming, the latest data we have is about 8% in urban Kunming. This chart looks at returns to different levels of education. The baseline is for people who only have 9 years of basic education. So for every level above basic education, you expect higher labor market outcomes for everybody. But the highest, we see the purple line shooting upwards, is for those who have bachelor's degree. And the second one, the green one, is for those who have the vocational college, the tertiary associate degrees. And the bottom two lines, they're getting very close, is the high school graduate as compared to the secondary vocational school graduates. That they are getting very close in terms of the labor market performance. What we did, which is quite interesting, is so there's a lot of talk about skills, how even people with education do not possess necessarily the skills required by the labor market. So the World Bank started a survey in 2012, being implemented in about 10 countries, looking at the returns to skills beyond the level of education. So the question is, for two people with the same level of education, does skill make any difference in their employment outcomes? This is the evidence from Yunnan. Basically, yes, but what type of skills? So I'm not going to go through the details, but if you have strong cognitive reading and writing skills, And if you have engage in more critical thinking in the job you conduct, or if you have computer proficiency and fluency in foreign languages, you tend to command higher returns in your wages. And finally, the interesting, we actually in the skills module, we had put in some measure of social emotional skills as designed by a psychologist, the Big Five test, looking at openness, to what extent people who are more open to new experiences or who are considered more creative, are they being rewarded by the labor market? The answer is yes. We also actually, at the same time, we also surveyed 300 employers in Yunnan, looking at asking them, what do you look for among your employees? What, when you make hiring decisions, what's important to you? And also ask them in terms of forecast for the job growth in the next 12 months. Here I like to say, if you look at all the occupations listed, in 2012 they're saying every occupation is expected to have an increase in the job openings, but the most significant is actually the technicians, associates. These are not university bachelor degrees, these tend to be associate degrees. So the employers in Kunming expect 100% increase in demand for technicians and associates. Managers also is highly in demand, but 80% increase, but the highest is for people with associate degrees. We also asked the employers, what are the trades, skills, or qualities you consider when you're making decisions about which employees to retain after probation? So type A is more professional manager. Type B is more frontline operator, service, sales. So it's quite similar. People primarily look for leadership. Job relevant or job specific skills are always there, but what's interesting is the skills in terms of leadership, communication. Similar in terms of personality, look for conscientiousness among the workers. There's some evidence in terms of skills gap. This is we look back 2 years on every quarter in terms of job openings versus applicants and versus number of jobs hired. There's inevitably, there are a lot of openings, there are a lot of applicants, but not every job is filled due to some sort of gaps and mismatches in the skills of applicants. So I like to again look at the system. When we talk about higher education, half of our students are actually in tertiary vocational colleges, and the other half are in regular university, and even fewer are in the 211 and or the world class quote universities. So starting from approximately 2005, the World Bank has been working with the Ministry of Education and also provinces in terms of improving the quality of vocational colleges. So now China has a pretty elaborate 示范, 高职示范, through nomination competition and heavy investment in those who are selected from both the central, provincial, and sometimes from donors, including the World Bank. We are operating in 4 provinces, and we are going to have Xinjiang next year, and we also have Asian Development Bank working in 2 other provinces. The model is basically you choose those Shifan Yuanxiao, and you pull heavily within the institutions to revise the training program, train the teachers, and put in the most up-to-date equipment and training facilities. But the key part is really in bringing the training program more in line with the labor market demand and really pushing the schools to revise the curriculum, and not by closing the door, discussing among a group of professors, but rather going out to the industry, going out to enterprises, ask them what are their standards for different type of occupations, how do we translate those standards into school-based curriculum. So this is a quick model summary. We start from the bottom by encouraging participation of industry in defining the standards, and based on that, develop the curriculum and provision of all the inputs and resources, and assess the students' teachers accordingly. Hopefully, we are trying to introduce a very virtuous cycle of vocational training that is demand-driven and respond to the needs from the labor market. We did a survey of about 20 colleges. To what extent each college is doing the demand analysis, to what extent industry is participating in the management, participating in the in developing the curriculum, some encouraging results, but still not pervasive yet. But we see a very critical core batch of colleges who are really engaging in this process of revising their curriculum. Some quick summary on achievements. So today we have, if you go to any of the Gaozi, especially to Shifan Gaozi, you see very vibrant collaboration at school level with industries. Very high employment rates. I'll give you a little bit more data on that. I know in the morning we heard from Mr. Wang, I forgot his name, but he was saying only 35% of the university graduates are unemployed. I'm not sure where the data came from, but what we have is very high employment rate. Of course, it depends on when we survey the graduates, whether it's within at the time of graduation, within 6 months, or 1 year, and so forth. But overall, the labor market and the job market maintains pretty strong in China. There are continuing a lot of challenges. The curriculum reform is quite uneven in quality in outputs and processes, and we need a lot more in-depth and institutionalized collaboration with industry on the standards and on the curriculum. There are also very obvious teacher or system constraints. Now schools do not yet have sufficient autonomy to hire teachers the way they want to. We continue to be subject to a very out-of-date standards and certification system published by the Ministry of Human Resources and Social Security. And the financing, we need to be a lot more demand side. And then the question of pathway to universities. Very few, even though we theoretically the vocational college students can go to university, but in reality only about 5% manage to make that migration. So the issue of a national qualification framework that would be conducive to integrate the vocational and general track will be an important issue going forward for China. So this is a data I'd like to share with you. There's really no national survey of university graduates, but we heard a lot of depressing stories of how graduates are not finding employment. We always try to understand, is that true? The bank really think, we've been interviewed also constantly by Wall Street Journals. What do you think about employment? What do you think of skills mismatches? But we really do not find significant data to substantiate that claim that graduates are not being employed. This is a private company founded by a PhD returning from the US, and he's really, his business is really growing. He specializes in independent graduate tracer studies of university students. And he's been doing that since 2007, so has built up the largest database ever in China of university graduates, including the vocational college graduates. I think he has about 500,000 students surveyed. And that's his summary of the employment rates. So the top blue line is for the 211 college graduates. It's about 93%. The middle blue line is for regular universities, about 90%. And the one that's increasing, the bottom, still in the bottom, but increasing is for the vocational colleges. Now we managed to reach about 88% of the employment rate. So thank you very much. I think my time just stopped, and I can take more questions during the Q&A session. Thank you.
Dr. Liang, I apologize for the wrong slides, and even with the incorrect slides, Dr. Liang gave us a very informative and fluent presentation. Let's give another round of applause to all the speakers at this panel. So next, we'll have Professor Altabak as the facilitator for this panel.
Thank you very much. My job is relatively easy. I was just asked to ask a few questions and maybe make a comment very quickly, and then open the floor to all of you to ask questions. And I will insist that you ask questions and not give a lecture. And if you are asking a very long question, I will stop you so that we have a chance for interaction. I had a comment, actually, on our first one of the slides of our first speaker, who said, globalization means Americanization. And I found that to be a very controversial thing to say, because my definition of globalization are the sort of broad economic, political, educational trends that are part of the global environment, and that although the United States still, the last time I looked, the largest economy, and still, in especially in the area of education, is probably the most influential system globally, nonetheless, globalization relates to many, many things. If you might turn the question on its head, and given current trends in economy, in technology, in ecology, you might say that globalization is in fact Sinophization, that China is the most important driver of globalization. And I'd be interested to hear the reactions of the rest of the panel to that. And is there a Chinese definition of globalization that's sort of generally understood? By the way, there isn't a broad definition in this country, or I think in the West, about what globalization is. And a challenge for all of us is when we hear that word, which we hear five times every day, the people who are saying it mean different things. So to try to figure out what it is. And of course, for us in the education business, for Xian Zhaotong Liverpool and others, to figure out how we fit in the global environment is a matter of great importance. And I think it's impressive that Xian Zhaotong Liverpool is very much thinking exactly of this. How does it fit? What does it want to adapt? And it doesn't want to copy. It doesn't want to be just another British university outside the country. All very interesting. So here's my question to all of you, and that is, what do you think is the best way to collaborate internationally? Is there a best practice that we can talk about? Our first speaker mentioned two very interesting examples, one historical, St. John's, the other coming into being, not yet there, which is NYU Shanghai. And of course, we had a very interesting presentation about Xian Zhaotong Liverpool. But are there generalizations one can take away from these examples? And then maybe we have brief answer to those questions, and then we're open.
So I think in China, there are lots of discussion about the globalization. So many people are afraid of that. In Chinese context, internationalization is not Americanization. But because when Chinese opened the door to reform the economy, so US as a model in terms of economic and education, so many institution or society to learn something from America. So that's why some people raise this issue. Internationalization not equal Americanization. So that's a very brief comment about this globalization is not the Americanization. And in terms of international cooperation for university, I think from our experience, I think there are several different levels. Currently, because Chinese has opened its door for international university or international higher education institute to cooperate with Chinese higher education sector to develop international cooperative university. For example, in China, in last few years, Chinese government have approved several. We have mentioned about Shanghai, New York, and the Kunshan Duke, and the Xi'an Jiao Tong Liverpool University in Suzhou, and Nordenham in Ningbo, Ken University in Wenzhou. I think that's one kind of cooperation, institutional level cooperation. I think there are lots of challenges for this new university because Xi'an Jiao Tong Liverpool University has run for 6 years, 7 years. It's not easy to be a successful international cooperative university because you have to face the challenge from culture, from the law system, from the government monetary system. So I think at the institutional level, there are lots of challenges. So all the institute which want to develop some international cooperative in China, you have to bear in mind about these challenges. But I think at the staff level for international cooperative, I think it's the better way is to develop, to strengthen some communication, to develop as more as possible channel for the staff to get mutual understanding about their common interests. So I think if there is no staff level mutual understanding, it's not easy to develop research collaboration. From our experience. So that's a quick response for your question.
Thank you. 感谢教授的评论。 我想我不多做解释, 正因为教授说, 全球化, 5个人有5种理解, 那么我也是其中的一种理解, 而且我比较 侧重的是跟我所讲的教育和文化的这个成绩在里面的价值有关，所以我认为现在美国是一种至少在高等教育在文化美国的文化价值观方面，在很多教育的理念方面，它确实显示出了一种霸权和强势。那么，So
Professor John agrees with Professor Altebach that five people have five different definitions of what globalization is. And I think Professor John's own definition is that United States has a lot of impact on liberal arts education, and also the US model in education is assuming a dominant role in the world. And that's why her definition of globalization lies in the sphere of education, but definitely recognizes US important role.
那么我想在寻求中国和国际的合作, 包括美国, 包括英国还有其他等等的国家, 实行, 大学合作的方面, 特别是在中国的土地上, 要搞两个国家的合作性的大学, 那么我想怎么样彼此的认识对方, 彼此的不但认识对方的优点, 也更重要的是学会批判对方的缺点, 恐怕是我们合作方面的一个最重要的基础。
So on the land of China, a collaboration between a US and Chinese university, the key is that how to understand each other's strength, but what is more important is really to how to understand and be critical of each other's weakness.
当然这里边可能更重要的问题就是我们回到现实中来的话，还是跟我讲的那个全球化的和美国化的问题有关。 所以在美国的强势文化面前，在中国社会事实上存在的 目前的关于中国传统和中国新价值重建的问题，在这个问题非常还处于一种彷徨和迷茫的时代，我想这两种的结合尤其是需要对于美国的批判。
So back to reality, we recognize that the US culture is still being very dominant, and especially at this critical stage, China is thinking very deeply about reconstructing and restructuring Chinese culture. So that's why being critical of each other, being aware of each other's weakness is really key.
最后我强调一下，在这个批判当中绝不是说把洗澡的时候把小孩和洗澡盆子一块，倒水的时候把洗澡盆子和小孩一块扔掉，而是强调的是我们更多的应该开发沉积在我们教育史上的一些普世价值。
So this is tough translation. So the key is not to get rid of everything, but really to preserve what the essence is. And being critical of the strengths and the weakness on both sides, and also being aware what the best collaboration could be for both parties.
Thank you. Thank you. We're open for questions and comments, please.
Two very closely related questions to President Xi. First, you claim that your aim is to establish a so-called internationally recognized international university.
It's fine. Could you possibly give us an example of such a university? For example, Harvard University. I am a Harvard PhD. I know Harvard has many outstanding international scholars, students, and international projects. But by nature, it is an American university. Just like it's different from British University of Cambridge or German University of Hamburg. So what's your model of a so-called international university? Then my second question is there a urgency or even necessity for China to establish a so-called internationally recognized international university? That's my two questions. Thank you.
I think this question related to the discussion about internationalization and Americanization. I think why we mentioned about internationalization. In our university, we have definition about internationalization at three levels. First is element level. When I visit many universities, when we attend the forum about internationalization or higher education, all the universities only mention about what's the ratio of overseas students or international students, what's the overseas staff ratio, or what's the class courses learn from use international textbook. And I think at our university, this is at the element level. That's some explicit criteria. But in our university, we pay more attention to the operation mechanism behind this criteria. That means university need to develop a platform to help the students, staff, to participate international academic activities and the community. That's the second level of internationalization in our university. The third level, in a globalized world, in order to be an international university, that means your students, your alumni, your staff should be a global player, should be participate international activity. So that's our understanding about internationalization. So I can give you some example. In order to be an international or global player, we help our students or push our students to participate the international academic activity. For example, we give all our students opportunity to participate international competition or contest. For example, America Mathematics Contest. All the students have opportunity to participate in this one. We don't use the internal selection process to select only top students, but we give all the students opportunity. We also give our staff opportunity to cooperate with other universities. That's participate in the international activity. And in terms of academic staff, we recruit staff internationally with a standard of world-class standard. That means we pay attention to research potential, to pay attention to the teaching quality, and also the commitment for the academic staff to the development of the new school. Currently, 80% of our student, of our staff are foreigner. I mean, in Chinese context, are not Chinese. In terms of nationality, 50% of them are non-Chinese foreigner. In terms of world senior or world-class scholars, it's a big challenge for a new university to recruit world first-class professors or scholars. So in last 2 years, we contract an international academic headhunter for us to find a senior or top world first-class scholars. Currently, we have nearly a little bit more than 10 senior professors. In future, we need to increase the top scholars in our university. That's some example of the internationalization or international university.
My number one question is addressed to 张教授。然后我相信在座的各位有很多会有想回国办学的这样的渴望。那么第一个问题，大家回国办学第一个问题都是如何得到 governmental blessing， 如何得到这个政府的许可。那么我想问一下，在您的研究中间，圣约翰，得到了这个，他面临办学面临了种种困难，而这个 NYU 上海却是一路绿灯。那么我想请问一下，这中间最重要的原因您觉得是什么？到底是因为现在全球化经济的必然性呢，还是因为 NYU 本身自己的名牌价值呢，还是因为 NYU 放下了像您讲的中间就是所谓的美国的优越感呢，还是仅仅因为某一位有 NYU 上面的高层和中国某一位官员关系很好？
So very quickly, a quick translation. The question is, St. John faced a lot of difficulty in its establishment. However, NYU Shanghai gained immediate approval. So what is the key point in terms of gaining government approval?
第一个问题，因为我觉得非常有必要的在这儿，非常简单的，因为时间的关系，我也不能说太多。因为 St. John's 这个学校，它有一个背景，就是它是一个殖民向那个全球化的，就是基督教全球化的这么一个殖民扩张的这么一个重要背景之下，所以它跟当时的中国的民族主义必然发生非常大的冲突。从它这个学校到中国开始，它就面临着这个问题。但是同时，圣约翰的年代，它又是在上海这样一个租界里头，所以它受到这个租界的保护。而且他一直拒绝在中国注册，他也能够生存73年，这是一个非常重要的和现在不同的地方。但是话要说回来，他正是因为借助了这个地方，而且他捷足先登，又有他非常好的办学经验，所以他是中国13所在美国在中国的教会大学当中，它是属于最早成功的一所学校。当然后来因为注册，因为种种的关系，所以它落在了南京的金陵大学和北京的燕京大学之后，但是始终是一个中国教会大学当中的名校。那么为什么现在的上海纽约大学它能够一路绿灯？那这个问题我想，首先得出一个重要的背景，就在于中国政府推出了一个叫国家教育中长期的改革与发展纲要，在这个纲要里头对中外合作办学，对教育的国际化，扩大国际交流，它不叫国际化，它叫扩大国际交流，提出了很多具体的设想。那么也就是在这个机遇当中，当然也有种种其他的关联，那个我可能在这儿我也不想说，但是在得之于这个机遇，所以首先是得到了当时主持教育的国务委员刘延东的支持， 然后上海地方政府也给予了实质的关心，所以这样才能够成功。我想是这样一个机遇。至于其他，如果大家有兴趣到中国办学的话，那我可能尽我所知可以回答大家的问题。谢谢。
Thank you very much.
Very quick translation. So, St. John's was not successful because the philosophy was really Christian occupation, which clashed with Chinese nationalism. However, we should also recognize that St. John was situated in a colony in Shanghai, so it was protected and survived for 73 years. And when it comes to NYU Shanghai, it was the perfect timing and the perfect opportunity because the government issued the educational reform, which visioned a lot of international collaboration between Chinese universities and American universities. So within this perfect opportunity, NYU Shanghai also gained the approval of government official Liu Yuandong, which allowed its immediate establishment.
My second question is for Xi 校长. I would like to ask you, as a new university, and then we all know that the Chinese people are extremely brand conscious, particularly when they come to colleges and universities. And when we say brand conscious, I really mean by ranking conscious. And as a new university, and then I know that personally, Xi 校长does not believe in rankings. I wonder, how do you market, or how do you brand this university, particularly for the parents and for the consumers?
Okay. For new university, it's a big challenge to attract the students and the parents. So at the first 3 years, very beginning of the first 3 years, I think most of parents and students were gambling to select XJTU because their Gaokao mark near the a little bit over the first tier line, because we recruit students at the first tier line. So I think many parents and students don't have more information about XJTU. So they select XJTU because their Gaokao mark can only enter a second tier university. So they think, okay, this university is a first tier university and also an international university. So perhaps this university is good. So I think at the first few cohorts, most of parents and the students select this one. I think it's a gamble. But after four or five years operation, we have our first cohort of graduates. Our graduate performance, excellent performance, demonstrates that the education quality is good. So I think university is a information asymmetry institution. So it's the best way for us to promote or to develop the band is to share what's your philosophy, what's your education model, and convince the students and the parents we are doing things in a right way. And then when they can understand the logic, and then they can find the results, then the brand will go up. So that's the basic logic for us to promote at GTIU.
Understand. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And my third question is for Dr. Liang.
Very brief.
Very. For your data about the employment, I wonder how much of the employment data actually comes from graduate, so students, undergraduate students entering graduate school and count as employment. They excluded. Okay, thank you very much. That's it.
尊敬的习校长，我想问一下，西安交通大学作为一所西部的学校，如何立足西部，培养学生，然后自身发展，贡献当地的社会和经济？谢谢。
Okay. It's not easy for the university which are located in the western part to develop, to compete with the eastern part. I think at least from two perspectives. One is for the university which are located in the western part will get much less than the financial support from the local government, because the local government don't have the money to support the university. And secondly, the top talent, for example, come from the United States to China. Most of them select Beijing, Shanghai, Guangdong. Few of them are willing to study, to work in the Western University, University which in Western part. So I think for the Western University, from my personal viewpoint, I think the most important things for these universities to develop is their unique features. They need to think what's their comparative advantages. But unfortunately, most of the university copy the practice of the other top university. They don't pay attention to their uniqueness, their own comparative advantages. So that's my my suggestion to the presidents of the Western, of the university which are located in the western part of China. Thank you.